Hello children, today I am here with the video for the students of class 7. This is chapter number 9, soil of your bio syllabus. In this chapter children, we shall be learning why soil is important as a natural resource, how soil is formed, what the soil contains and what is soil profile. Also we will be learning what do you mean by soil erosion. So children, you are suggested to keep your pencil along with you so that you could underline the important topics by pausing the video. Let's get started. Soil is one of the most important natural resource. Yes, it is the natural resource because soil cannot be manufactured in the factories using chemicals. It is provided to us by the nature only. That is why it is an important natural resource. It provides anchorage to the plants. Anchorage means the roots of the plants remain fixed in the soil. And these roots absorb water and nutrients from the soil itself. It is the home for many organisms like rats, earthworms, snakes. All these organisms live in the soil by digging a hole. Also, we human beings build our houses on the soil, that is on the land itself. Soil is essential for agriculture. Agriculture provides food, clothing and shelter for all. Agriculture, by growing crops we get food. By growing crops like cotton we get clothing. And it provides shelter because due to agriculture, due to growth of plants, we get wood, and that wood is used for making houses. Soil is also used as raw material for building bricks and tiles, which is used to build a house. Soil is thus an inseparable part of our life, means which cannot be separated. We cannot imagine our life without soil. The earthy fragrance of soil after the first rain is always refreshing. Yes, children, nowadays as you must be experiencing, rainy season is there, and when there is the first rain of the day, the earthy fragrance is always refreshing to us. Soil teeming with life. Teeming means full of life, swarming with life. One day during the rainy season, Paheli and Bujo, these are the characters present in the NCERT book just like you children, observed an earthworm coming out of the soil. Paheli wondered whether there were other organisms also in the soil. Let us find out. To find out whether other organisms are present in the soil or not, we shall be doing an activity. Collect some soil samples and observe them carefully. You can use a hand lens. Examine each sample carefully and fill in table number 1. This is table number 9.1. When you will be examining the various soil samples, we will be filling this blank with the observations we have done. In garden soil, grass is present, small plants is also present, animals like ants, insects like earthworm, moles, these are also present. Any other observation? The garden soil will be darker in color. So similarly, you have to collect the various samples of soil and you have to observe and fill in the blanks. Paheli says, I wonder why I found some pieces of plastic articles and polythene bags in the soil sample collected from the roadside and the garden. Polythene bags and plastics pollute the soil as these are non-biodegradable items. Non-biodegradable items means these items do not decompose and do not get mixed with the soil. They remain in the soil for thousands of years and thus decreasing the fertility of the soil. They also kill the organisms living in the soil. Yes, they create a blockage which eventually kills the organisms living in the soil. That is why there is a demand to ban the polythene bags and plastics. Other substances which pollute the soil are a number of waste products coming out from the factories also, waste products coming out from our houses also. Chemicals and pesticides. Pesticides are the liquids used to kill the pests. Waste products and chemicals should be treated before they are released into the soil. Yes, they should be sent to the treatment plant to make them less harmful. In treatment plants, they are said to be done less harmful. Their harmfulness do not vanishes, but it becomes less harmful for the soil or the environment. The use of pesticides should be minimized. Next topic of discussion is soil profile. Soil is composed of distinct layers. Soil profile, let us see. And to see this, we shall have to perform the following activity. Take a little soil, break the clumps with your hand to powder it. Now take a glass tumbler and fill it with 3/4 of water. Then add a handful of soil to it. Stir it well with a stick to dissolve the soil. Now let it undisturb for few minutes. After some time, you will be seeing this kind of thing. You will be experiencing or observing this kind of thing. You will be seeing that the soil has been distinguished between in different layers according to their particles and particles of different sizes. As you can see here, at the bottom of the tumbler, the heaviest particles, that is the gravels, they settle down at the bottom of the tumbler. Above the gravel, there are sand particles which are less heavier than the gravels. Gravels means small stones. Above the sand particles is the mixture of clay, the fine particle of the soil. Above the clay, there is muddy water which has been created due to mixture of water and soil. And on the top of the surface of the water, you will be seeing that some dead rotten plants, rotten materials of plants and animals are floating. This rotten dead plants and animal material is known as humus. Underline the statement, humus. The rotting dead material present in the soil is called humus. Humus are the dead materials of plants and animals which rotten and get mixed up with the soil, and thus increases the fertility of the soil. You probably know that soil is formed by breaking down of rocks. All of us know that soil is formed by the breaking down of large pieces of rocks. First of all, the large pieces of rocks are broken. There is a cracks or crevices up, and with due course of time, these large pieces of rock turn into fine particles of soil. This all is primarily done by the action of wind, water and climate. This process is known as weathering. So, underline the statement. Soil is formed by the breaking down of rocks by the action of wind, water and climate. This process is known as weathering. Since weathering is the natural process, it is done in the nature only. That's why soil is an important natural resource. The nature of any soil depends upon the rocks from which it has been formed and the types of vegetation that it grows. A vertical section through different layers of the soil is called soil profile. You can see this vertical section in a recently dug ditch for a well or tube well. You will be able to see as the ditch is dug below the surface of the earth, the color of the soil is changing. Each layer differs in texture. When you will feel the soil of each layer, you will find a difference. You will feel differences in the texture, in the touch. color, depth and also chemical compositions. These layers are referred to as horizons. The various layers, as you can see here in the picture, these various layers are referred as horizons. Look at the picture. In the top you can see the soil is darker in color and the maximum plants are growing on the topmost layer of the soil. This is the most fertile layer of the soil. Below this top layer, as you can see, the color of the soil is little lighter than the first one. Below that there are pieces of rocks and at the bottom is the bedrock, means from these rocks only the soil has eventually formed with due course of time. We usually see the top surface of the soil, not the layers below it. Yes, we cannot see, but we can see this in the recently dug ditch for a well. If we look at the sides of a recently dug ditch, we can see the inner layers of the soil too. Such a view enables us to observe soil profile at that place. Soil profile can also be seen while digging a well or laying the foundation of a building. It can also be seen on the sides of the road or on a hill or at a steep river bank. Let us now see what these different layers are. The uppermost horizon is generally dark in color as it is rich in humus and minerals. The humus makes the soil fertile and provide nutrients to the growing plants. This layer is generally soft, porous. Porous means water can seep easily and can retain more amount of water. This is known as topsoil or the A horizon. The uppermost layer of the soil is known as topsoil or A horizon. This is the most fertile layer of the soil due to the presence of humus in it. And just due to the presence of humus, the soil in the top layer is darker in color. This provides shelters for many living organisms such as worms, rodents, moles and beetles. The roots of small plants are embedded entirely in the topsoil. Yes, as you can see in the picture, the roots of the small plants are embedded entirely in the topsoil. But the roots of the bigger trees, taller trees, go deep below the A horizon. The next layer has a lesser amount of humus, but this layer is rich in more minerals. This layer is generally harder and more compact, means there is less air and water traps, means the particles are closely packed. Compact means these particles are very closely packed and there is very less spaces for air and water to get trapped. This layer is called, the second layer is called B horizon or the middle layer. The third layer is the C horizon, which is made up of lumps of rocks with cracks and crevices. As you can see, there is bigger pieces of rocks and there are crevices between the rocks also. Below this layer is the bedrock or the parent rock, which is very hard and difficult to be dug with a spade. Now let us read about soil types. As you know, weathering of rock produces small particles of various materials. These include sand and clay. The relative amount of sand and clay depends upon the rock from which the particles were formed. That is the parent rock. Underline the statement, the mixture of rock particles and humus is called the soil. What do you mean by soil? Soil is the mixture of rock particles and the humus. Living organisms such as bacteria, plant roots and earthworms are important parts of any soil. Now let us see. Soil is classified on the basis of proportion of particles of various sizes, means what is the proportion of particles, whether the particles are very small, whether the particles are small, neither too small nor too large, or whether the particles are very large. If soil contains greater proportion of big particles, it is called sandy soil. If the proportion of fine particles is relatively higher, then it is called clayey soil. And the mixture of sand and clay, that soil is known as loamy soil. This is the third category of soil. So there are three types of soil in general: sandy soil, which has larger pieces of larger proportion of particles. Next is the clayey soil, which has relatively higher proportion of fine particles, and the mixture of fine particles of sand and clay is known as loamy soil. The size of the particles in a soil has an influence on its properties. Sand particles are quite large. You all of you must have seen the sand particles. They cannot fit close together. Yes, since they are larger in sizes, they cannot fit together closely, and thus there are large spaces between them. These large spaces can be filled with air and water. We see that sand is well aerated. Aerated means air and water can easily pass through the sand. Water can drain quickly through the spaces between the sand particles because the particles are relatively larger in size. They could not fit close together. So sandy soils tend to be light, well aerated and rather dry. Why they are dry? Because of the spaces present between the particles, the water quickly drains away. Clay particles, being much smaller, pack tightly together, leaving little space for air. So as I have said, in clay there is higher proportion of very fine particles. These fine particles are very closely packed to each other, leaving very less spaces for the air. Unlike sandy soil, water can be held in the tiny gaps between the particles of clay, and since these are closely packed, so water can be held in large quantity. There are no spaces so that water could drain away quickly. So clay soils have less air, but they are heavy as they hold more water than the sandy soils. The best topsoil for growing plants is the loam. As I have said, loamy soil is the mixture of sand, clay and other type of soil particles known as silt. Silt is the particle which is brought down by the rivers. Silt occurs as a deposit in the river beds. The size of the silt particles is between those of sand and clay, means these are neither too large nor too smaller. The loamy soil also has humus in it, and it has the optimum water holding capacity, which is very good for the growth of plants. So best soil for growing plants is the loamy soil. Now here is an activity. Collect samples of clayey, loamy and sandy soils. Take a fistful of soil from one of the samples. Remove any pebbles, rocks or grass blades from it. Now add water drop by drop and knead the soil. Add just enough water so that a ball can be made from it. But at the same time, it should not be sticky. Try to make a ball from this soil. On a flat surface, roll this ball into a cylinder, as you can see here the picture in the next pages. So you can knead the clayey soil, you can knead the loamy soil also, but can you knead the sandy soil? No, it is not at all possible to knead the sandy soil. Let us now read properties of soil. We will be doing an activities to find the characteristics of soil. First of all is percolation rate of water in soil. Percolation rate means the rate at which a sample of soil absorbs a specific amount of water. Bhucho and Paheli mark two different squares of 50 × 50 cm each, means 50 cm wider, 50 cm longer, on each on the floor of their house and the other on the Kachcha road, unpaved road. They fill two bottles of the same size with water. They emptied the water from the bottles, one each, at the same time in two different squares. They observed that the water on the floor, which is pakka floor, flowed down and was not absorbed. But on the Kachcha road, on the other hand, the water was absorbed by the soil. Now let us perform an activity to understand this. This is activity 9.4. For this activity, you need to divide yourself into three teams. Let the team name be A, B and C. So you will be finding how fast the water passes down the soil. This is known as the percolation rate. How fast the water is absorbed by the soil. How fast the water passes down the soil. You will need a hollow cylinder or a pipe. Ensure that each team uses the pipe of the same diameter. Some suggestions for obtaining such pipe are given below. If possible, get a small tin can and cut off its bottom. Or PVC pipe, approx 5 cm in diameter, is available, cut into, as you can see in the picture also. At the place where you collect the soil, place the pipe about 2 cm deep. Suppose you have taken a tin can and you have cut the bottom of the tin can. Now you need to place this tin can inside the soil about 2 cm deep. Now pour 200 ml of water slowly. 200 ml of water can be easily measured by taking a cold drink bottle. For measuring, note the time when you start pouring water. When you have to note the time when you will start to pour the water inside this tin can. And when all the water has percolated, leaving the pipe empty. Percolated means absorbed, run down. Note the time again. Be careful not to let the water spill over or run down outside the pipe while pouring. So for calculation, from the above experiment we have been explained that we have noted, suppose we have taken 200 ml of water and it has taken 10 minutes to absorb quickly, absorb completely down the soil. So rate of percolation can be calculated. There is a formula, percolation rate. Amount of water, we have taken amount of water in ml. In this activity we have taken 200 milliliter of water and divided by percolation time, means the time taken by the water to get absorbed completely into the soil. So suppose we have taken 200 ml of water and it has taken 20 minutes to get absorbed completely, then 200 when divided by 20 gives us the answer 10 ml. Means rate of percolation, that sample of soil can absorb 10 milliliter of water per minute. Next property is moisture in soil. Have you ever passed through a farmland during a hot summer day? Perhaps you notice that the air above the land is shimmering. Shimmering means it is giving a shiny appearance. Why is it so? Let us do the activity to find out the answer. Take a boiling tube. Put 2 spoonfuls of soil sample in it. Heat it on a flame and observe it. As you can see here in the picture, 2 spoonful of soil is taken in a heating tube and the tube is heated slowly on the burner. After few minutes you will see tiny droplets of water on the inner side of the heating tube. So on heating, water in the soil evaporates and moves up and condenses to form the cooler inner walls of the upper part of the boiling tube. As you can see here, this is the cloudy formation here, and this is because the water vapor, with water which is present inside the soil, get evaporated due to the heat, and after touching the cold surface of the heating tube, here it get condensed to form tiny droplets. On hot summer day, the vapor coming out of the soil reflect the air reflect, and the air above the soil seems to shimmer, means give a shiny appearance. This happens because during the hot summer days, when the intensity of sun's rays is too high, the heat of the sun evaporates the water present inside the soil and it gets reflected. Therefore, the air above the land gives a shiny or shimmering appearance. Next is absorption of water by the soil. Question arises, do all the soils absorb same amount of water? Let us find out. There is an activity. Take a plastic funnel. Take a filter paper or a piece of newspaper sheet. Fold and place it as shown in figure 9.7. Then take 50 gram of dry powdered soil and pour it into the funnel. Measure a certain amount of water in the measuring cylinder. Suppose we have taken 100 ml of water or 20 ml of water. We have taken 20 ml of water and we have taken 50 gram of soil. And pour it drop by drop onto the soil. You can use a dropper. You are not supposed to pour the water down quickly. You have to pour the water drop by drop. So for this you can use the dropper also. Do not let the water fall at one spot. So you need to spread the drops over all the surface of the soil. Pour water all over the soil. Keep pouring till it starts dripping. As you can see in the picture, the soil sample is taken inside the funnel, which is already covered with the filter paper or the newspaper. Then water is added to the taken soil sample drop by drop, and what happens after a few minutes? The water starts to drip down the funnel. Now, subtract the amount of water left in the measuring cylinder. Suppose we have taken 20 ml of water and we need to pour this water drop by drop into the soil sample till the water starts to drip down the funnel. And suppose we are left with 8 ml of water. This is the amount. Subtract the amount of water left in the measuring cylinder from the amount you have started with. We have started with 20 ml and now we are left with 8 ml. So what the result we get after subtraction? Means 12 ml of water is retained, is holded by the 50 gram sample of soil. This is the amount of water retained by the soil. So, record your results in your notebook in the following manner. Weight of the soil. Weight was taken. Amount of soil taken was 50 gram. Initial volume means the volume with which we have started. So, initial volume of water in the measuring cylinder is UML equals to, suppose, 20 milliliter. Final volume of water in the measuring cylinder is 8 milliliter. Volume of water absorbed by the soil equals to 20 minus 8 equals to 12. Weight of the water absorbed by the soil. You can say this is the weight of the water absorbed by the soil because 1 ml of water equals to 1 gram. Now percentage we can calculate by this formula. u minus v divided by 100 divided by 50 into 100. Weight of soil is 50 gram. Initial volume of water. Initial volume of water is written as UML. And we have started with this activity with 20 ml of water. Final volume of water left in the measuring cylinder means the amount of water we are left in the measuring cylinder is 8 milliliter. Now we can calculate the amount of water absorbed by the soil. U means the initial volume of water. Final volume of water is subtracted from initial volume of water, which is 20 minus 8, and we get the result 12 milliliter. We can also say 12 gram of water is absorbed by the soil, as 1 milliliter equals to 1 gram. Now we can calculate the percentage of water absorbed by using this formula. So U minus V divided by 50. 50 is the amount of soil taken multiplied by 100. On calculating this, we get 24%, means out 24% of water is absorbed by the 50 gram amount of soil. You can repeat this activity with different soil samples. So do you get the same results? No, it is not at all possible that you will be getting the same results. Now discuss the results with your friends and answer the following questions. Which soil have the higher percolation rate? Of course, sandy soil will have the higher percolation rate because there is the presence of large particles which are not closely fit packed to each other, leaving air and water spaces. That is why air drains out quickly. Which soil have the lower percolation rate? Clayey soil will have the lower percolation rate because of the presence of very fine particles which are very closely packed to each other, leaving very less air and water space. Next topic of discussion is soil and crops. Different types of soils are found in different parts of India, because India is a country with various diversities. In different parts of India are found different types of soil. In some parts there is clayey soil, in some parts there is loamy soil, while some others there is sandy soil. So soil is affected by the wind, rainfall, temperature, light and humidity of a place. And this also affects the cultivation of crops, the crops grown in that particular area. These are some important climatic factors which affect the soil profile and brings the changes in the soil structures. As I have said, these climatic factors as well as the components of the soil, these are the key things which determine the various types of vegetations and crops that might grow in any region. So clayey soil and loamy soil are both suitable for growing cereals like wheat and gram, because such soils are good at retaining water. For paddy, soils rich in clay and organic matter and having a good capacity to retain water is ideal, means the clayey soil is best for growing paddy. For lentils, means pulses, dal and other pulses, loamy soil which drain water easily are required. And for growing cotton, sandy loam or loam soil is sufficient. Crops such as wheat are grown in the fine clayey soil because they are rich in humus and are very fertile. Now here is the question, which kind of soil would be the most suitable for planting rice, means paddy? Soil with higher percolation rate or lower percolation rate? You need to discuss with your teacher and find out the answer. Next topic of discussion is soil erosion. The removal of land surface by water, wind or ice is known as erosion. Plants root formally bind the soil. In the absence of plants, the soil becomes loose, so it can be moved away by the action of wind or flowing water easily. Therefore, the removal of topmost layer of soil by the action of wind or water is known as soil erosion. Soil erosion of soil is more severe in the areas with little or no surface vegetation, means even there is no plantation of grass, such as desert lands or bare lands. So cutting of trees and deforestation should be prevented, and effort should be made to increase the green areas. Therefore, preventing soil from getting eroded is known as soil conservation. And soil conservation can only be done by planting more and more and more trees, because roots of the plants bind the soil. Now here is a case study. Some children visited to Leeladhar Dada in Madhya Pradesh. And Leeladhar Dada was preparing the soil to make items like surahi, matki, kalla. These are the earthen pots. Let us see what conversation has been done in between the children and Leeladhar Dada. Where was the soil obtained from? Dada answered, "We brought the soil, black soil, from the piece of a barren land." Now, how is soil prepared? How is soil prepared for making earthen pots? Dry soil will be placed in large tank and would be cleaned off pebbles. After removing these things, the soil will be soaked for about 8 hours. This soil would be kneaded after mixing with horse dung. Yes, this mixture of horse dung and the clay gives the soil a very smooth texture to touch, and that after that the soil becomes easier to give any shape. The kneaded soil would be placed on the wheel and given appropriate shape. The final shape is given with hands. The items are colored after 3 days of drying. These items then are dried under the sun for 3 days, and after 3 days these items are colored, and then these items are first dried in the sun, then they are baked at high temperature, and after that they are colored with various colors to make them look more attractive. Burnt horse dung helps to open the pores in the soil so that water could percolate out of the matkas and surahis to make the water kept in these earthen items cooler. Let us revise what we have read in this chapter. Soil is important for life on the earth. Soil profile is the section through different layers of soil, where various layers are called horizons. Soil is of different types. There are basically 3 types of soil: clay, loamy and sandy. Percolation rate of water is different in different types of soil. It is highest in the sandy soil and least in the clayey soil. Means sandy soil has higher percolation rate and clayey soil has lowest percolation rate. Different types of soils are used to cultivate different types of crops. Clay and loam are suitable for growing wheat, gram and paddy. Cotton is grown well in the sandy loam soil. Soil holds water in it, which is called soil moisture. The capacity of soil to hold water is important for various crops. And clay soil is used for making pots, toys and statues. I hope you have understood the chapter well. Follow the instructions uploaded in the school website. Thank you, children.